Good day.
Talking is not unusual for you.
In real life.
In real life.
No. It's a lovely thing. I enjoy working silent for an audience because it's so intimate. You know, when I'm in a theater, when suddenly all the sound is gone, you have to look at them, they have to look at you, and the connection is very deep and intimate, because there's no words to distract you. You know, they're really looking at every line of your face, and I'm really looking back at them. But in everyday life, I find being able to speak convenient.
So when was there a time where you came up with this idea as a performance?
I was in college, I think, and I began to be really tired of the idea of magic patter. Because most magicians would be saying this really stupid shit. You know, they'd be saying, here I have a red ball. Yeah. You know, redundant, dopey stuff, pretentious stuff. In this very room, the great Houdini once, you know, passed out. So it was a rebellion against patter. And it was just to say, I believe I can lie to the audience without speaking to them.
And did you study the great silent performers, or did
no,
you just
No, not
kinda...
really. I just shut up. That's going into character for me is shutting up. It's just very simple. Other people have to go deep down, you know, to fill their imaginary drawers. I just shut up. Mm.
So you've been doing magic for, what is it, 30 years, longer?
I've been doing magic for 60 years.
60 years?
Yes.
You're not 60. Are you 60?
I'm 65.
Good Lord. You've aged well.
I have the best life in the world. I mean, I do have the best life in the world. I'm here at the Geffen directing a play that Todd Robbins and I wrote together, that we had a wonderful run with off Broadway, and that they're now doing an even beautifuler production of here. Mm-hmm. I have a movie that, to my great astonishment, seems to be to call up strong feelings in lots of people. The people seem there's this. I had no idea how this movie would be received, because we did screenings about once every 2 weeks at Penn's home with friends, mm-hmm. and people seemed to like the movie just fine. But then we took it to Telluride, and there was this swell of love that came out of the crowd, and big laughs where we knew that it was funny, but we didn't know it was that funny. Mm. You know, it was amazing to see.
So when did the directing bug get you in the first place? Because I did go to your Macbeth in New Jersey.
You saw it?
Yeah, we went to Red Bank.
Holy cow! That's the first big thing I've done recently in the last mm-hmm. in the last 5 or 10 years. I'm doing The Tempest next spring, and I'm doing this here. And the directing, which is directing, is really just a form of writing, and I've always loved writing. Mm. When I say that, I mean, in this case, we shot 2,400 hours worth of footage, 2,400 hours of footage. And so what you have to do is you have to go through, that's like having a dictionary. You have to go through that dictionary and now write a story. Mm. And that's fascinating to me.
So is that but obviously with the theater pieces and whatever, it's a little bit more constrained.
It's different, but it's so, it just pulls every bit of every resource that you have in you out of you. Johnny Carson, I think, once said that if you're on television long enough, you will end up doing everything that you've ever done, and that's exactly what directing a play does to me. You know, I don't sit there and go, well, go over there. I'm leaping up on stage, pulling out every bit of knowledge I've ever had to solve these problems, and this movie. When we started this movie, the working title of it was Vermeer's Edge, because we thought it was about Vermeer. We thought it was about Vermeer technology. And we thought that our friend was investigating that, and that we'd be making a movie about Vermeer. And then as the process progressed, we realized that that wasn't really the subject of the movie at all. The subject of the movie was our friend, this amazing man who set himself an impossible problem, solved it, failed, and then solved it again, and then achieved this gorgeous work of art.
So when you decided to do it, was it were you full out from the beginning? Was it kind of a, let's start putting some cameras on him and see what's coming of this?
Do you know the story behind how it got generated? Have you seen it?
From the movie, but not from...
Well, here's what happened. Penn, I think, was feeling a little trapped because, you know, we're doing our show really successfully in Vegas. He has a lovely family, but the sort of adolescent, let's go out all night and talk with friends, just wasn't happening for him mm-hmm. anymore. And he seemed sort of edgy, and he wrote a somewhat desperate letter to Tim, who's an old friend of him, of Penn's, and said, Tim, could you do me a favor and just fly to Vegas and have dinner with me? And, you know, Tim can afford to do that. So Tim flew to Vegas, and they went to one of those Brazilian restaurants where they pile meat on your plate, which is obviously something that both Penn and Tim enjoy. And they talked, and Penn said, now tell me about something that has nothing to do with show business. So Tim said, what do you know about Vermeer? Penn said, like, Dutch painter, right? And girl with the pearl earring? And Tim says, yeah, I've been thinking a lot about Vermeer. And he pulled off his belt a video camera, because Tim's the kind of guy who carries a video camera on his belt. And he showed Penn the footage of the basic invention mm-hmm. and the picture he made that was a copy of his father-in-law's high school photograph. Mm-hmm. And Tim went, wow, that's amazing. What are you going to do with that? Tim said, well, I think maybe I'll just sort of set up like a studio like Vermeer's in my warehouse in Texas, and I'll try to paint a Vermeer. Maybe I'll like make a YouTube video on it. Penn says, no, don't lift a brush. Don't do another thing. This is a movie. So Penn's desperate endeavor to do something having nothing to do with show business led him directly to one of the biggest show business things we've ever done. And the two of them then went off and tried to sell the idea of the movie, tried to get funding for mm-hmm. it from people like, you know, PBS and BBC and all the usual suspects. And nobody would do it. Mm. Nobody would do it because I think two reasons. One, it sounded like a real off-putting academic topic, you know, like something that you'd go to a college class and learn about. Mm. And two, because Penn and I have such reputations as deceivers, you know, that I think these producers thought that this was going to be some kind of put on, that they'd get all their money and then we'd fake this painting thing. So nobody would go for it. But Penn, who was just captivated by the idea, I mean, he's the executive, produced by guy. He's the main produced guy right. by on this movie, because it was his passion for this event that got it all in motion. You know, he willed it into existence, and he said, "Well, we'll just do it ourselves, because nowadays we have this digital video technology that is so different from even 5 years ago. You can do things now that you couldn't do even 5 years ago because it's cheap to shoot. It's 2,400 hours of footage." That this movie was pulled out of. So, and then they're sort of thinking about who should direct it, and Penn looks around, realizes that he's got somebody who's been directing our show and various pieces of theater and my little zombie movies, those little movies called And Teller. Have you seen mm-hmm. them? They're pretty funny. And I did this Play Dead, and I did a film of Play Dead. And he said, I think if Teller does it, it's going to be a very different movie. And they called me up and said, do you want to do it? And I said, sure. So the three of us then collectively produced the movie. Mm-hmm. This whole movie, we live in this wonderful age where a small group of people, a small band of outlaws, can really do something on their own thanks to digital technology. So this whole movie is made by about 10 people, you know, 10, maybe 15, but nothing like the hundreds of people that you usually have. And that's why it's got such a very personal point of view. You know, no one outside our group had any effect on any of the editing of this movie, on any of the assemblage of this movie. Nobody said, make this longer, make this shorter, I need more funny in here. This is all us. This is us doing it ourselves.
So how did you figure out or decide how to do a lot of the footage? It seems like some of the footage is a kind of a set camera in his studio that he built. Some of it is interview stuff. I mean, there's like a wide range of kinds of footage you guys went after.
Including incredibly cheap at times. You know, there's some footage that you look at and you go, wow, is he in front of a green screen? Because the quality of Buckingham Palace in the background is so sort of shaky. Well, we didn't know. We had been begging Buckingham Palace to let us get Tim in to see the original of this painting. And they said no, and said no, and said no, and said no. And we were over in England. We finally got through to David Hockney. It took us almost a year to get through to David Hockney. And then he was wonderfully cordial. But we happened to be in England, and suddenly the Royal Collections guy said, okay, come on over. By that time, Penn and I had left. Farley Ziegler, the producer, happened to have a video camera with her. They said, you can't shoot anything in the room. So Tim went over with his little his little binocular glasses to study the painting, studied it for half an hour. And incidentally, afterwards, they said, are you sure there's no cameras in those glasses?
Well, I guess Google Glass now. You could.
I guess, yeah. You know, they think, he came out of the thing just, vibrating, and Farley said, okay, grab it. And Tim, I think, threw one of those little digital recorders that you get from Radio Shack in your pocket. and so that key moment did get captured, but only because we have this digital video capability now.
So do you think the film is better for that kind of thing? That it's...
Would I rather have had a beautiful image on a red camera like the rest of the movie? Yes. I would rather have had a lovely camera crew there and good sound equipment and not a lot of wind. However, maybe it is better. Maybe it is better because you know that it wasn't staged. You know, this film does not look like a reality show. This film looks like something that people captured as they could. Now, you talk about the cameras. Tim had five cameras on every brushstroke. It varied from 3 to 5, but roughly 5 on every brushstroke. So we always had lots of angles on things, and sometimes these are, most of the time they're those Canon digital cameras that he's put in place. You see them in the movie somewhat. Sometimes we had a cinematographer who worked with us on some of the more beautiful, graceful shots that we needed for the beauty of it.
Make it more like a movie.
Yeah.
Does that photo array of him doing the work designed by you, or was it something he kind of already conceived of? Or
he designed it. He designed it. He's a smart guy. If this movie would not have happened if Tim had not been extremely video savvy. And so, yes, he designed, he set up the cameras every day. You know, there's no cinematographer there fancily setting it up. When Tim's talking to the camera, he's not talking to me. He's talking to Farley on Skype. Every day at the end of the session, he'd sit down and do his Skype diary. So, of course, we had a gazillion Skype diaries to work with. And fortunately, because Tim is a funny guy, a lot of those were funny.
So what was it like finally digging into the 24,000 hours?
It was a year, is what it was. It was a year. I had a great editor here in LA called Patrick Sheffield, who was great not just because he has a wonderful sense of video imagery, but because he delved deep into this. He knows just about as much about all of the technical and scientific and historical stuff as Tim does. He had to, because his first job was to look at that 2,400 hours of footage and say, okay, where's the base stuff? Where's the where's the 5 hours that we start with? And he sort of scooped it together, and one of the first things he did was that great montage of Tim building his room, which he originally edited to a piece by the Propeller Heads called History Repeating. Great song, and it was edited as a music video to that. And it remained to the Propellerhead soundtrack really all the way through until the last phase, when we realized that we really couldn't change the voice of the film. And the musical voice of the film, the music narrates the film, Penn narrates the film, and to suddenly jump to a new musical narrator, it just wouldn't be nice. It just didn't seem right. And if we ever release a music video, I would release that, because it's hilarious, because History Repeating is what Tim's doing.
Right. Probably also very expensive, that particular piece of music.
It was pricey. I mean, we priced it out, and I met with the guys, Alex Gifford I met with, and he's a wonderful guy who loved the film, mm-hmm. and we would, you know, we would have gotten it for a price. That wasn't the determining factor. We were prepared to pay that price. It just wasn't the right choice.
So was the film there at the 5-hour version? Did you kind of see what was going to be pared down? Or?
No. It was... We went through many phases before. I think it was... at one point, I wrote a treatment for it where I looked at everything there and I said, okay, this is a story about Tim. This begins with Tim's process, it ends with Tim's process. Now, this is not a light decision, this is not an easy decision, because remember that we're dealing with all of this technical and historical artistic stuff that has been a considerable stir in the art community. Philip Stedman and David Hockney, both, when they dropped their little bombshells into the artistic community, there were ripples, and still are. And we thought at one point that that might be what this film is about, another mm-hmm. piece of that ripple. It just took a lot of looking at the film to say, you know what, no. The story of this film can be stated in this sentence: Tim paints a Vermeer. And once we had that mm-hmm. to work with, that began to give us a way to pull all of that stuff out of the footage. But the original title of the film was Vermeer's Edge, as I said. And that, because we thought it was about technology.
Well, there's something particularly about that the Hockney sequences, which are so unexpected in a way. I mean, besides his age, which is a little shocking at times, but also the fact that it's kind of like artists talking to artists. It feels very intimate and not structured in some way, or him as an expert. He just seems like a guy who loves art.
He's a delightful guy. He's a delightful guy. Hockney. Hockney had some bad experiences with documentaries, so he was reluctant to let us shoot. Said, you know, when we said, "Can we bring cameras?" His assistant said, "I wouldn't do that if I were you." But we stuck cameras in our bags, not big, beautiful red cameras, not our wonderful cinematographer, but us holding these little handheld cameras. We stuck them in the bag just in case. And Hockney received us as sweetly as a person could. He took us to his house. He made us lunch. Tim sat down next to him at lunch, and they started to talk. And within 10 minutes, they were brothers. You know, they knew each other, because they both... They both love technology, and they both love the way technology and art can go hand in hand. They're both obsessed with making beautiful images, and neither of them is a bullshitter at all. So they saw that. And so we finished our lunch, and Hockney was eager to hear about, he knew that he was going to see something interesting. And he said, "Let's go up to my studio." And when we were about to go up there, I said, "David, we have a couple of little cameras in our bags. Could we take those along?" And he said, "Oh, sure." So we took them up. And that's another situation where the sound is being recorded by little things stuck in people's pockets. Mm-hmm. And we had one of those genius sound engineers afterwards come in and go through it syllable by syllable so you could understand what was going on.
Yeah.
But yes, they became, they're natural friends.
Well, it's funny, shooting these, we shoot about 200 half hours a year.
Oh my God.
And the experience of basically running and gunning, and we're using an LED light instead of a Diva light, which is much bigger.
Yeah.
I have found that as we talked about changing things, that the idea of actually formalizing and creating a set and doing all those things that you would traditionally do for an interview show, in some ways would be a loss. You know, that there is this intimacy that's created by these small cameras and the kind of flexibility of it, that the quality of the sound, as long as you can hear it, is not life and death. It's really capturing that moment that people connect with.
Yes, this film could not have been made without that technology. If we had had to bring a 35mm camera with us to Hockney, it wouldn't have happened.
Yeah.
You know, if Farley had to have a 35mm camera and a crew to capture that moment when Tim came out of Buckingham Palace and went, "I'm fucked. I'm completely fucked. I can't, essentially he was thinking, I can't do this with my invention."
Mm. You know. So were there things that you shot that were on other areas of the conversation? I mean, I think one of the things about the movie is you come out of the film asking questions. I mean, my big question walking out of the cinema was the fact that are art forgers using this technology that he discovered? Because you would think it would be a great tool for an art forger.
You would think of that. And Tim has talked about that. Vermeer's dad was an art dealer. Hmm. And in those days, copies of paintings fetched good prices. So the idea that this technology might have come out of a technology for forgery is not impossible. That's one of the things that Tim speculated on this.
But not the point of the movie.
Not the point of the movie. I'll tell you another, I mean, there's so much, to be able to do the simple story of a guy makes a painting, you have to leave out so much, you know, because there's so much that had to go in. You as a viewer, you have to know what a camera obscura is. You have to know how the retina works. Mm-hmm. You have to kind of know the history of the research on this stuff. There's a lot of stuff, and you don't want people to feel like they're being taken to school. So hence getting the funniest artist in the world, right? Martin Mull. Getting Martin Mull, who's his real occupation is he's a painter. His sideline is he happens to be one of the funniest men alive. He's also a great musician. But to get him in to have a conversation with him allows us to learn something about the camera obscura and how he, you know, Vermeer might have used that while still getting some great laughs. Because the danger of this thing sinking into academic gloom was always present, and we were always mindful of it.
So I think almost as much as the fact that he's funny is again, much like Hockney, this interesting thing of artists learning something. And you're as an audience, you're now in their experience of not being Tim, but you're being the person kind of trying to figure out what Tim's up to, and you have that point of view, which I think really works in the film.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, Hockney's such an adventurer. You know, so Hockney, I don't know if you know this story, but when Hockney was about to graduate from the Royal College of Art, they told him he had to write a satisfactory essay. Hockney said, "Well, but I'm an artist. I make pictures. You judge me on my pictures." And they said, "Essay or you don't get a diploma." So Hockney turned in a picture. It's in the shape of a diploma. It says diploma in the background. Mm-hmm. In the middle of it, there are two big figures. One is a sort of hulking black figure with a school tie, jack boots, a Hitler mustache. He's standing on the backs of hunched over oppressed young artists. He has his hand upraised in a Nazi salute, and perched on top of his hand is the would-be graduate. And the would-be graduate has two faces and is fending off the crest of the Royal College of Art, which is mirror reversed, so it's the opposite of what it should be, distorted, and spewing a black miasma that has prominently the word rules. They took a look at this painting, this picture, and they gave him his diploma. You know, so he's always been kind of, you never know what to expect out of Hockney. He suddenly, bang, now he's making pictures out of Polaroids. When Polaroids first came in, iPads and iPhones come in, and you can now do graphic stuff on them, and he brings 60 years of skill to that. He's an unpredictable card.
The mystery of the artist has changed, I think, unfortunately. We've become such an exposed culture in the last 5 years, at least. Holding on to that is hard, I think.
I think that's correct, but I don't think it's a loss. I think it's a lot like a magic trick. If I do a magic trick and I say, "Well, I just did that with a thread," it takes away the magic. But if I tell you everything about the thought process that went into exactly how that thread is used, exactly how the lighting works, exactly how I choreographed everything with that thread, if I bring you fully onto the other side, the mystery ends up being greater, not less. And that's, the response to this painting when we brought it out at Telluride, I mean, people who saw exactly how this thing was done, reacted to it much more powerfully than they would have reacted if he just hung this picture up.
Mm-hmm.
So by knowing everything behind it, the mystery isn't gone, it's just greater. It's shifted to humanity and away from sort of a, you know, that sort of woofy hippie thing where you don't want the artist to be intelligent and hardworking. You want the artist to be some sort of supernatural being who just walks up to a canvas and magically paints with light. Mm-hmm. That's what kids want. You know, it's a childish way to view things. I think that the idea that your parents would sneak around and slip presents under the Christmas tree is much more beautiful and important than the idea of Santa Claus.
Mm. It is. And I guess when you grow up, that's what you think about.
Yeah. Once you're past childhood, the big mysteries are wonderful.
Well, I guess the thing is that the artists, and you guys have been doing this for so long, but the willingness, the balls to put it out there and to not be afraid of losing that, using that mystery to some advantage is ultimately the stronger play.
And you still do it very carefully. I mean, we don't show you everything about how Tim made this painting because you'd be bored spitless. We show you the greatest moments of his tedious process, and we underscore them with the perfect music to capture that longing that he had to be Vermeer, and we punctuate it with jokes. You know, so we're not showing you everything. We're not telling you the truth. We're telling you only a portion of the truth. But there's a big truth in that too.
But the same true of you and Penn over all these years, yes?
Yeah, yeah. But, you know, we don't explain how every magic trick is done.
Right.
We explain the ones that are interesting enough to entertain you. You know, to delight you.
Well, always the punchline of a magic trick that is never explained. There's always the punchline of the magic trick that's not explained. It seems like the
bigger idea. There's still There's an old Latin expression, omnia exeunt in mysterium, meaning everything goes away into mystery. You know, you go far enough with anything and it gets more mysterious. It's like knowing somebody for years. I think Penn is more mysterious to me now, after working with him for nearly 40 years, than he was when I first knew him, because I oversimplified him when I first knew him. And now I know that there is something deeply unknowable about him, and I love that.
So when did you know the movie was where you wanted it to be, or close to where you wanted it to be? Was it right near the end of cutting, or were you?
Yeah. I mean, I'll tell you the turning point for us. I interviewed Tim in San Antonio, and I said, Tim, are you going to succeed? And he went, oh, I think so. And the very opening section of the movie, where Tim says, you know, if I do it, it's going to be a remarkable thing because I'm not a painter, comes from that interview. Mm. And it was the moment when I found, I remembered that piece of footage, and I said to Patrick, try that at the top of the movie, try that at the head of the movie, that I knew that the thing was going to go together. Because that then really told us what the story of the movie was going to be. It's like Dorothy singing Somewhere Over the Rainbow.
So you knew that was your story. That was your
once we had this
thesis.
Once we could hang all of these complex ideas, and it's loaded with complex ideas. Once we could hang those complex ideas on the longing to paint a Vermeer.
I think it was your story.
Okay. On the longing to paint a Vermeer, then I was confident.
And you knew in the moment that he said the words came out of his mouth in the interview that...
I didn't know then, but I knew when we placed it at the beginning of the movie that was now the idea of the movie.
So how did you deal with Telluride? Did you watch the movie with the audience? Were you listening for every breath?
Well, you know, we had only screened it previously in Penn's home theater for like 16 people at a time. And we did that frequently. Because the technical ideas in the movie that have to slide gracefully and unobtrusively into your mind have to be clear, or you can't fathom what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
So we did that for that clarity and to get a sense of the rhythm of the humor in the movie. But the first time I saw it with an audience was with Telluride. And what astounded me was how many people came out moved They were moved by it. I thought, well, people will be interested in this, and they'll laugh a lot, which they do. But there were people who would come up to Tim or to Penn or to me and say, thank you so much for making this movie. And I think these are probably people who work in the arts in some way, mm-hmm. and who realize that the public doesn't know that when they see that amazing thing on the screen, that's the product of somebody's, you know, of a year of somebody's life. Mm-hmm. And this really shows that idea, that that to get to that kind of amazing beauty, it takes time, it takes pain, it takes determination, and it takes a sense of humor.
And do you guys just jump into each other's arms at the end, like at the end of a football game that somebody just won, when you realize the audience went where you wanted them to go? Or
I'll tell you, the moment that I was pretty sure the humor would land right is when Patrick Sheffield, our editor, timed this so that Tim says, because I'm not a painter, and the screen goes to black, and then the title comes up. And Patrick said, if that black gets a laugh, then you know that they're with you. And when that happened, I went, ooh. And then, listening, especially the rhythm of the humor in the movie, hearing people laugh at all those points when you're not doing a joke, right? Mm-hmm. Another day more dots is not a joke. Another day more dots is a joke if you've just watched a guy do dots for 87 seconds. Mm-hmm. All of those non-jokes that are really funny because you're with us. When I would hear those responses, I was going, oh my gosh, they're really getting this.
And your pleasure in having done it, is it at the moment that the movie is done? Is it it going into release? Is it how it does with people? How many people see it and things like that?
I'm getting pleasure from all of that. I like sitting and watching the movie because at last I can see the story that was there over those 4 years that it was so hard to find, it was so hard to identify. So I get pleasure out of that. I get pleasure out of individuals talking to me about it. I love the sound of the laughs rolling over the audience. I'm stunned that it's gotten the reception that it's gotten. We really were making a personal little movie that we thought would maybe appeal to artistic types, but it seems to speak to a lot of people.
It's a good feeling, eh?
Yeah.